three songs from Barbara Strozzi from different editions, and then Jay, and Emma, and Laura, and Peggy will play sonatas by piano, two solo violin sonatas, and a couple of trio sonatas by Weigel. These two last offers are the object of recent study by our special guest to this, one of our three special guests of the Music in Conference this year. In this case today, Professor Guido Olivieri, who is professor of musicology at the University of Texas in Austin, where he also leads the ensemble Austinato and works a lot with pre-1800 chamber music and historical performance practice. Guido is actually originally from Naples and is, I would say, the most important specialist at this point of not just Neapolitan music in general in the 18th century, but he is finishing a book on instrumental music of the 18th century in Naples, which is probably one of the most overdue studies in the history of music of Naples, which everybody knows Naples has been one of the most important centers of music in the 18th century, especially also, of course, for Dramma per Musica, for Opera Buffa. This morning we had, or in the beginning of the afternoon at least, we had a presentation of Valeria La Grotta, who presented some cantatas, which is also part of Neapolitan repertory that is not enough studied, but especially instrumental music, and that's even closer to my heart because the cello was born in Naples, contrary to popular belief. I think that it was born in Bologna, it was actually born in Naples. And Guido Olivieri has been one of the scholars who has brought back to our attention the music by Supriani, by Franceschiello, by Calò, by Marchitelli, by Mascitti. Actually, he's finishing the editing of a book which is the conference proceedings from a conference we had in Villa Santa Maria too many years ago, but this on Michele Mascitti and Pietro Marchitelli, who were composers born there in Abruzzo and who were active not just in Naples. Marchitelli remained mostly in Naples, sort of the Corelli equal of in Neapolitan music at that time, but Michele Mascitti was one of those violinists who then emigrated, went to Paris, and was active as a composer, publisher of his music in the first 40 years of the 18th century. So we start to get more and more of a picture through the many articles that Guido has published over the years. We're starting to get a better picture of Neapolitan instrumental music in the 18th century. And so we are very much looking forward to the time the book comes out to get finally a full picture of 18th century instrumental music. So Guido was also a former president of the Society of 18th Century Music. And so it's a pleasure for me to join him in this masterclass. We will, as I said, start with Naomi, Tung, and Laura with three songs by Barbara Strozzi. As I said, published in a variety of her publications. Say the middle of the 70s. Thank you.
Thank you. just want to thank everyone, and particularly Mark, for the invitation. I'll have more to say tomorrow, also about the two composers that were mentioned before, but it's a real pleasure for me to be back actually here at Musikum after a few years. So let's go to Barbara Struzzi. Wonderful interpretation, beautiful voice and delivery. I like very much the way in which you interpret, especially the second part, where you actually, we could feel that you are happy, right? So in this music, of course, the text is crucial, is fundamental to interpreting really the feelings and contrasting feelings, right? That there is in this song. I think that, well, first of all, let's get from you. What is your impression of this song? What do you think is going on here?
I think it's a little, it shows Barbara Struzzi's sassy side. She is basically saying, she says, don't tell me to sing.
Right.
About any of this, because what is the point if my love is so far away, and bring it to me and then I'll sing, for sure.
Absolutely, yes. You interpreted perfectly correctly this text, and I'm sure you know a little bit more of the personality and the figure of Barbara Struzzi, and from this, we don't know exactly if the text was from her herself or was written by others, right? But we can tell that there is a certain independence, right? The idea of a personality that emerges and imposes, right? Which, for the time, was quite unusual, right? We are certainly in the middle of the 17th century, but the virtue of women at the time was considered silence. Right? So if you have your feelings, you keep it quiet. And here we don't have it. It's beautiful in the second part. Right? Don't tempt me to play, that's the translation. I find that very appropriate. Don't tell me to play for the glory of heaven, right? I'll send you to the place where there is no shortage of other good musicians besides yourself. And we are almost right with the F word there, right? Don't tell me this. So I think that we can do more about the contrast between the sections. One way to do that is to be extremely flexible in the singing and in following the text. Right? So when someone is really upset, right, tends to express in more faster delivery, right, mm-hmm. or more concentration, right. Nobilite gli occhi, potere d'amore. And then, especially when you have repetition. Now, repetition is a rhetorical effect also nowadays, right? I repeat something one, two, three times because I want to say this, I want to see this, I said this, right? So, nobilite gli occhi, chi occhi. So, giving a little bit more emphasis on this kind of repetitions. Do you want to try a little bit this? And of course the continuo is following, so
yeah.
you are leading.
Thank you. feel a little bit of this rage and this indignation, right? And of course, you know, when you are speeding up, it means that you are fighting, in a sense, sometimes with the syllables and with the text, right? Mm-hmm. And you are doing a great job in interpreting the, your pronunciation is perfect, so I have nothing to say. What one way to move to organize this, for example, from measure 3-4, perché dirò che siete dei musici il flagello, che siete dei musici il flagello. So you can speed up in the second half of that phrase.
Okay.
Perché dirò che siete dei musici il flagello, mm-hmm. e degli amanti. Okay, so you can, in this way, you can work out a little bit, negotiate a little bit better, right, with the problems of, because if you do one phrase, it becomes difficult even for a native speaker. Che siete dei musici flagello e dei diamanti. I mean, it's a little bit rolling of your tongue, right? And the other thing is, this music is really music with the text, right? We are underlining it. So, for example, measure 9, where you have no, no, si, nor, no. Now, the continuo has one of the few moving lines, right? But you can take a little bit more time there before starting the next phrase. So, having, you know, separating a little bit more and more space and emphasizing this signor no, mm-hmm. she's really denying this. And what is interesting here is that, of course, then she says, "I will not sing. I will not open my mouth." And then you have all the melisma. I will not do that. But then I do. Yeah, so that is great. And then, yeah, in general, a little bit later, measure 22, right, where you have a chi a chi cantare mio si bell'idolo mio lungi e da me, and here is a real. Almost a madrigalism, because lungi, far from me, right? And she puts this long notes. So let's have a very beautiful solution.
Okay.
So starting with. So we can feel that it's really far from us. Do you mind going back to the from the top and let's give you more. I let's try to nominate.
Okay.
So be very, very free, also because the continuo is holding the notes right there. So you have all the freedom you like.
Okay. So our first verse?
Yes.
Oh,
And maybe the last touch that you can add here is having that, what is written as an eight note blast, like blue, right? So separating and giving this sense of long, maybe we can do from 17 this second.
There, but I think
really was saying, you can be even more theatrical. So this just basically confirming much of what you said. But I think what's important here is that the unity of the song remains complete. Mm-hmm. It doesn't fall into the frames.
Okay.
Do I thought, shall we take the time to do one more run through of it?
Sure.
With that in mind, let's see. You continue.
Let me say one thing with the continuum, maybe in measure 22, is edition 22, 23. That's your part, but just a little bit, not covering, because she has this misadvotion, just not to overcome the voice too much. So
I think the misadvotion can be.
Yeah.
Just
for
the second verse, maybe? Sure. Give a chance to get all those words in.
Thank you.
slowly tense. I think here, I mean, she's playing really with, and this is the most difficult part, with the registers. The higher and then deep, not only at the end, it's observing, right? Dealing really with this idea of on the ground. But that's one of the entire piece. I'm sure you have noticed that at a certain point, the voice starts to be, in a sense, separated from the continuum. And then, at a certain point, it joins in this lamenting line, right? So it's like this feeling is taking over. Again, beautifully interpreted. I think that you applied also some of the things that we were discussing before. Yes, that's fine. Well, the very beginning is really like a call to attention, right? Udite, udite, udite amanti, bagagione. And then you have this exclamation, oh Dio. And here I feel that once again you are, expressing some sudden feelings. So she's starting saying, listen to me, and then, oh God. So let's have this break in emotional feelings. Mm-hmm. Having a little bit of space before that sea, mm-hmm. then more emphasis. Oh, so getting more like really an expressive sign almost. And this is also something that happens when she did, later on when she describes the singularity. This is measure 51 and following. Singularity, right? So she's jumping with the line. I think that, I don't know, maybe we don't agree on that, but perhaps here, even being a little bit less beautiful than the voice, but breaking a little bit the voice, okay. Is singularity. Okay, I'm exaggerating, of course, and I'm not as wonderful as you are interpreting. But I think that here, we need to feel what she's describing. And then I think you interpret very well instead the speed, right? So you take that little breath. Can we try just the very beginning with these two times in which she stops the narration, in a sense, right? The introduction with this odd deal.
Feeling that this A is
coming at some point, but we need to really die with that upper. That's fine.
That's the art, the rhetorical art of delivery, is not just to, you know, honor what's in the text, but that's the actio, that's the pronunciatio, that's the Vortrag, as the Germans call it. You know, this is where you take the part. You know, the elocution, the writing, the parts of the talk or the musical piece that is written down goes to a certain point. That's really the first half. The second half is performance. So that these are the things that you can add to it to give it even more spike, especially in the lamento ways. So just be, you know, sliding over what they're doing. So don't continue, don't listen to what she's doing. Just know what
listen to me.
Is so that you know where to get out of the way, where to push her a little bit. And if she's not along with you, don't worry, keep going. Because she knows you will be there, but she has to be able to know that you will be
there.
That's the hard part. So maybe we can start from Che si fil prede, la fede, la fede.
Okay.
And then get into the one.
Yes.
Thank you. And this means that I insisted that they had to take care of
turning the pitch to text, right? But for reasons that are connected and related to the publication itself, was not possible. So graphic writing, I understand that it's not easy to read from an edition that is not conceived for these are little things but very important. So I appreciate definitely the effort that you're doing in this, especially the we said that Piani was a virtuoso, right? A virtuoso violinist. And this piece is, it's apparently very nice and very elegant, but it's not easy at all. It has some passages that are a little bit tricky in terms of technical demands. And this means that, there are some elements that need to be worked out. He believed a lot in the idea that it's the bow that gives the expressivity to the sound, to the music. And you can experiment that a lot of this sonata writing is based on string crossing. So I think that you can give a little bit more emphasis on the articulation with the bow. So starting with the largo, right? We have this largo, and Piani puts this staccato. This is in the largo. So he is clearly interpreting this movement as a French style with dotted. And I think we need to feel this element of grandeur of the first. So if you can use a little bit more bow in there, even the tempo, it's fine. You can perhaps push it a little bit faster, but even at that tempo, giving this impression really of the French grandiose style. So using the a little bit more go into the string.
Especially when you get those,
give the impression of going faster, and you'll have more of that longer.
Yes, absolutely.
Maybe we can.
Why don't we start from the top? Between the violin and the
can we start a little bit from the top?
Thank you.
happens twice, right, in this couple of vision. You can create again a contrast in terms of the hands. So you have different effect, but a rhetorical game is a repetition. So we need to do something that involves and that captures the attention of also the audience and communication. And the same So pianoforte, or in the second time, so the second time I think that it would work 26, 27, better forte, pianoforte. Right? Wanna try a little bit that?
Into this movement of transformation of the Italian style into a mixture of Italian and French style, the gourmet, the reunion of tastes. And, well, this sonata has a little bit of the reunion of these tastes, but it has also very strong, I think, very strong Neapolitan roots and perhaps it was written when he was still in Naples, not when he moved to Paris.
Emphasize is again this dynamic contrast and
creating more of a crescendo in the crescendo, for example. So you did a little bit in some places of this first movement, but you can, especially since the two instruments are joined, you can start a little bit softer and then creating a crescendo toward going with the line, right? And then the beginning, it is written spirituoso. So maybe be a little bit more flexible with that, not too rigid in terms of tempo like this, so that you have a rhetorical beginning.
Sequences.
that was great. Then when you get to this barrelage over the open street, you know, that's, I call that a little Neapolitan moment.
Yeah.
That's really a sweet little thing. Yum, pom, pom. And actually, in the second violin, you get that leap of an octave and the bass too. So I don't know if you're aware of that when you have the parts. I think that's a nice to so that you have to feel you're sort of noodling around your there. Yum, pom. And that's a moment of not different speed, but a completely different affect. So you can even be more sort of sweet about it, and then get back to that's all in terms of the structure.
Absolutely.
Make a lot of sense. Can you do just one last time, and then we can maybe, we still have time for a piano also. With the repeats, yeah. Yeah. So you can do the repeat.
And the late 1716 indicates that this is a time when he was still in Paris. So perhaps he was looking to publish these two, but he didn't manage to.
And this also has never been played before.
You're free to play.
Yes.
Complex and elaborate writing, right? And then perhaps
perhaps come and a little bit nerves. You started with a very fast tempo. The second movement was so. Perhaps eventually that will be the tempo. Maybe for now it's better to start a little bit with a slower tempo. But let's go to the largo ed amoroso. And so here is really a matter of thinking of the large and longer shape, right? So Henry Major has this usual emphasis on the downbeat, but it is like a sort of lullaby, right? And this amoroso, lovely feeling that we need to have. So it's very important. I mean, you will find every time on the down go, right? So it's a little bit strange, but we need to keep this idea of one. Let's try it. And your tempo.
Take that a little more amoroso, a little slower. It's a little hurried.
Yeah.
It's, yeah.
I mean, we don't disagree, actually.
No, okay.
to choose the tempo.
I mean, we disagree maybe with the ideas. You said, I don't want to impose my tempo.
Yes.
Because I think you sort of, exactly where we arrive, I think you settle in a tempo that is a little more on the rose already. Mm-hmm. So if you were to start it,
no,
not even, and I really think of, I like that new Boeing, because those you know, we call them Boeings, but these ties or these slurs don't really meant Boeings until much later in the 18th century. They just mean articulations. Mm-hmm. So the composer gives ideas about articulation, about what notes belong together, but a composer would never pretend to tell a musician, a professional musician, how to perform. This is my composition idea. Now, you're a professional, do you do it? It happens to be the same guy, so you're not practicing. But in any case, I think that and look at the second bar, you have a score. You have a 6-5 chord. So I think that first bar is really for a doubling bar to the second bar. Then you have another interesting word with that triple D sharp. So I think you can take a slightly larger units in the phrasing and go very much with what you see in a continuum. I know you have to think of your own part, but I think now you can help a lot. You both have this heard saying that a zillion times, whenever you see 7, this is 5, and you're better for 2, but that's what we want to go to, and sort of stay away from the 3-5s, and then there's nothing to fit in the 5. So, but that gives a lot of shape in the baseline, and go with that. So here again, we have a situation where the basso continuo is so-called supposed to follow, but it's really actually helping you get where you want to get. And if you had the original, you probably would only have your part and not the bass line with the figures, which the cellist always has. And so that's where your role comes in to sort of help her along and explain the harmony. And so she can float on top of it, right?
Before we start looking again, I think that the character here is different, right? It's not no longer a monotone. And you have imitation thing, which is a typical Neapolitan tree also. And it is a very, decides, right? So I would separate it a little bit more, the giving this sense of rhythm, right?
A little bit slower.
Thank you.
fun with some inventions, really. I don't know, the end also. Or something like this. So creating something that, surprise a little bit the audience. That's what I don't know.
Maybe just a general thing. Baroque music, especially in the beginning of the 18th century, is still a lot about illusion. So if it's really hard, there are tricks to make it sound like it's going faster than it actually goes. Right? So, and I think one of the best tricks there is to think it much more horizontal. You have so much imitation. So if you think on but even go further on you have a whole long melody. You don't have to go much faster to give the impression that actually this is going faster. And then when you have a counter subject, is there. And actually the second time you played it, because you were quieter, she didn't feel like she had to rush there, and things were much more together. And of course, once you expose that first idea, then you can start messing around with it, playing around with it, and alter the regularity of your measurement, which also, often creating the impression of a certain speed, of a certain tempo, a certain character, also has to do with how you manipulate time. And the way you manipulate time is the way you basically fall in or out of regularity of beat. So I think in a movement like this, you can really give the impression you're going there and then you don't. Or you give the impression that you can go very far and then you put an accent. But these kinds of general things are very useful tricks to give the audience the impression that you're going off faster. Because you make so much more happen, and basically the perception of how much is happening will create another type of information. So I think you can take it even a little bit slower and go more contrapuntal than, again, very, very harmonic things like that. And there's a lot of nasty passages, both for the bass and for you. I think, especially at the stages of pretty much reading it for a third time, this might give you a question that it's fast. That would be great. So can you try maybe just the beginning and play around with some of these ideas in the bass lecture?
Thank you.
Thank you so much to everyone.